too, and some police violence that was happening in New York in 2015, 2016. My parents are in the audience. This is a first, so I'm gonna read from this book that very much deals with them. So I'm happy to have them here. So this book is told from the perspective of someone who's in college and is home for a few days. And he's really interested in trying to like understand a little bit more about his mother's past as an activist. Mom caught me shuffling toward the coffee machine. "Out with CJ all night," she said, "smoking that Mary Jane?" An inspector solving a too easy case. I looked at the dull green lines of the stove clock and saw it was past 10, which meant 1 in the afternoon New York time. I sniffed my shirt, but didn't detect any trace of weed. "Mary Jane," and I deflected to Mom. "Come on." "Uh-huh. Mothers know some things." She swung her arms in wide arcs from side to side, slapping her shoulders and kidneys with loud thwacks. Some ancient Taoist morning routine she'd recently begun. "No wonder your grades are slipping," she said to me. I rubbed my eyes and inserted a capsule into the machine, one of those sleek pod-based towers that added to the plastic gyre in the ocean with every serving. I pushed a button and the inside roared, sending a creamy string of espresso into my cup. I took a sip and the liquid was eerily rich and fresh coming from that vacuum-sealed pod. More importantly, my nervous system tingled to life. "Smoking is just a form of medicating to deal with the anxieties of late capitalism," I said. "It's one of the least destructive things that I think I can imagine." "Please," said Mom, "do what you want. I went to college too, you know. The stuff always just made me sleepy." I added this to the sketchy picture I had of Mom's Berkeley years. "Thank you for that, Mom. I'll carry forward the family tradition of fighting the man and smoking Mary Jane." Mom wagged her hand at me. "I never said you should do it. You slept till 10 and you still look like hell." She pulled down the flesh under her eyes to illustrate. "I'm saying you should learn from your mother's mistakes." She stopped swinging her arms and gestured toward the dining room table. I sat across from her and ran my hands over the dark grain of the wood top. It was a new addition. A trapezoid of morning light fell across it and caught the steam rising from my coffee cup. The whole thing was ready to Instagram, a perfect image of the bougie comforts Mom had cultivated piece by piece to create catalog-ready images like this. Mom folded her hands on the table. "I don't support your dropping out of college plan, and not just because I'm your mother. I've been there, and it's painful, the whole Black Asian situation." She inhaled as if to dive underwater. "Your mother co-founded something called the Black Korean Coalition in the 1980s to stop all the violence in South Central." My mind lit up, blazing a connection between Mom's words and the half dozen meetings and teach-ins on Black Asian solidarity we'd held in the last year, trying to string together an alternative history, proving that we were more than shopkeepers harassing their Black customers, parents suing to overturn affirmative action. But the histories had started to feel thin. I thought of all the pictures I'd seen of Yuri Kochiyama, a Nisei grandma with her permed hair, but wearing a Free Mumia t-shirt, and Grace Lee Boggs, the revolutionary theorist who organized urban farms in Detroit. I heard so many spoken word tributes, had watched so many indie documentaries on them, that though I'd never say it aloud, the attachment was starting to feel a little desperate. They were exceptions proving the rule of Asian anti-Blackness, lighthouses accentuating the fogginess of the coastline. "Mom," I said, "wow, we need that story. This has to be related to the Rodney King uprising and LA and Saegu, right? 429, that abbreviated Korean name for the April day their stores were set aflame, a low point in our Black Asian timeline. This would totally remake the popular narrative. Maybe you could lead a workshop or a teach-in for us, or we could do an oral history." "Wah," said Mom. "I've never seen my son so eager to talk to me." it's not exactly a happy story. No, no, of course. I mean, we'd have to take a trauma-informed approach. My son. She put up her palm to stop me. There are things I'm happy to share if they help you understand what you're doing out there. But I'm not going to polish it into some toolkit you can circulate to your activist friends. These young organizers always come to me saying, ah, auntie, can you mentor me? And I say to them, first, I'm not your auntie. I'm not that old. And second, what the fuck for? I don't have any answers. Usually, they just want someone to listen to their problems. I pictured all of my activist friends saying exactly that, the yearning and eagerness in their faces, and I felt my own desperation, my sudden childlike need. Exactly, I said. It shows how few Asian American activist models we have. Most of my friends' parents and grandparents don't even support Black Lives Matter, let alone teach them movement history. Movement history, said Mom. God, you make me sound so old. She crossed her arms, smug at having the upper hand. Aren't you grateful to have such a cool mother? Thank you.
Would you like to read from your book?
Sure. Thanks everyone for being here and for having me here. I love Ryan's book. It's really funny. And I still remember us talking about it at that weird cafe where the guy was trying to take the selfie of himself through the empty picture frame. You know what I'm talking about? It was this cafe with like a lot of mirrors and a bathtub in the middle. And you were explaining this novel and I was just like, I can't understand where we are or visualize what it's going to be. But no, I'm really excited to have this conversation because even though I wrote a memoir about a different sort of, I would say it's sort of like adjacent to some of the stuff you're talking about, like in terms of California history, American history. There are just so many overlaps, not like Adidas slides are in both of them, but also just sort of these kind of mother, parent-child relationships that sort of go against some of the tropes of Asian American writing. So the title of my book is Stay True. It's a memoir that I've been working on for quite some time, and I'll just read a little bit of it and then explain what it was. Back then, there was no such thing as spending too much time in the car. We would have driven anywhere so long as we were together. I always offered my Volvo. First, it seemed like the cool, generous thing to do. Second, it ensured that everyone had to listen to my music. Nobody could cook, yet we were always piling into my station wagon for aspirational trips to the grocery store on College Avenue, the one that took about 6 songs to get to. We crossed the Bay Bridge simply to get ice cream, justifying a whole new mixtape. There was a 24-hour Kmart down 880 that we discovered one night on the way back from giving someone a lift to the airport, the ultimate gesture of friendship. A half-hour drive just to buy notepads or underwear in the dead of night, and it was absolutely worth it. Occasionally, a stray, scratchy pop tune would catch someone's attention. What's this? I'd heard these songs hundreds of times before, but to listen to them with other people, it was what I'd been waiting for. I'd taken my parents' fear of blind spots to heart, and my head constantly bounded from side to side, checking the various mirrors, noting cars in neighboring lanes, in between sneaking glances to see if anyone else noticed that Pavement was far superior to Pearl Jam. I was responsible for my friends' safety and for their enrichment, too. I have a photo of Ken and Susie sitting shoulder to shoulder in the back just as we're about to embark on a short road trip. They're chewing gum, smiling. I remember nothing about the trip except the excitement of leaving for someplace else. Finals were over, and before we went our separate ways for summer, a bunch of us spent the night at a house a few hours away from Berkeley. In general, I wasn't used to seeing Ken in the back seat. We spent a lot of nights driving around Berkeley, his leg propped up on the passenger side door, his eyes scanning the horizon for undiscovered coffee shops, some out-of-the-way dive bar that would become our haunt once we turned 21. He was always overdressed, a collared shirt, a polo jacket, things I would never wear. And maybe it was just that he was ready for adventure. More often than not, a song's drive to 7-Eleven for cigarettes. At that age, time moves slow, You're eager for something to happen, passing time in parking lots, hands deep in your pockets, trying to figure out where to go next. Life happened elsewhere. It was simply a matter of finding a map that led there. Or maybe at that age, time moves fast. You're so desperate for action that you forget to remember things as they happen. A day felt like forever. A year was a geological era. The leap from sophomore to junior year of college suggested unprecedented new heights of poise and maturity. Back then, your emotions were always either very high or very low, unless you were bored, and nobody in human history had ever been this bored before. We laughed so hard we thought we'd die. We drank so much we learned there was a thing called alcohol poisoning. I always feared that I had alcohol poisoning. We stayed up so late, possessed by delirium, that we came up with a theory of everything, only we forgot to write it down. We cycled through legendary infatuations, sure to devastate us for the rest of our lives. For a while, you were convinced that you would write the set. For a while, you were convinced that you would one day write the saddest story ever. I'll probably just stop reading there. So the book takes place in the mid-1990s. I grew up in the South Bay of California. It's about sort of my family and my upbringing, but it's also just about that kind of search for self that I think a lot of people experience when they're teenagers. And if it wasn't clear, like, I was very snobby about my tastes, and I basically saw college as an opportunity to just, like, meet all the people that were exactly like me. Like, that's the only thing I wanted, was to meet people who were into the exact same esoteric things as me. And the book is about a friend I made, this Japanese-American kid, and I think this is like a micro distinction that really only makes sense to certain, maybe even like just certain generations of Asian Americans, that like a fourth generation Japanese American kid is just an alien to a first or second generation Taiwanese American kid. And my friend Ken just seemed so assured. He was not into any of the same stuff as I was. And yet, over the course of like smoking hundreds of cigarettes, staying up late talking about movies, we became very good friends. And the book is sort of a tribute to him, because between junior and senior year of college, he was killed. And my immediate reaction was to just turn the page and to write down everything. And the book took me, I don't know, like 24 years to write, because I was just really fixated on reconstructing that past and creating this world. And yeah, it takes place in Berkeley in the mid to late 1990s. And there's actually a lot of overlap, I think, with like the political conversations in Ryan's book. I can talk more about it, but that's just sort of how the book begins. And I was convinced that it would one day be the saddest story ever written, but I think it's actually very funny, because a lot of it is just me making fun of how ridiculous of a teenager I was. So.
Yeah. Well, I have a lot of thoughts, but I'll just start with the fact that you're making fun of your teenage self, because I think both of you are really good at describing these sort of killjoys, these characters that are, you know, I know yours is a novel, but it's sort of loosely a relationship that resembles superficially one that you actually have. And I want to talk a little bit about what it means to write yourself as this, like, buzzkill. Because in hindsight, right? Like, as I'm reading Hua Hsu, college student, music snob, feeling a lot of ways about things, I actually agreed with 90% of those opinions. We were all that person, right? Like, oh my God, I want to be caught dead at, you know, the Dave Matthews Band show or whatever. But
still never heard a full Dave Matthews Band song. So
hasn't changed. But I also know you too personally as I think as an educator and as, you know, as I'm going to call you a spiritualist, but somebody who's very much in touch with, you know, the full breadth of life. You're not killjoys now, and in fact, it's kind of in your job description to be really open-minded. So, like, how do you look at what's your true self? What's your ego actually want to be saying? Like,
wow, that is a deep question.
You
know your true self. So.
As I was writing this novel, my MFA thesis advisor and I came up with this theory that, you know, between the ages of like 18 and 24-ish, there's almost something like primal and evolutionary in humans where you have to divide the world into binaries, like good, bad, right, wrong, cool, not cool, right? And this is actually like an essential function of like humanity continuing. That's why like so many protests and movements happen and start on campuses, right? So Reed, the narrator of my novel, is very much in that mode. He's 21, he's at Columbia, and he's like, burn the world down. Just like looking for things to be upset about. And it's not that he's wrong, it's not that he's incorrect politically, but he just needs to like chill out a little. And the narrator of Hua's memoir, young Hua, to me is like a very similar thing, except his battlefield is cultural. It's like, if I stake out my correct cultural tastes here, the world will become a better place. And we just have to like really educate or get rid of all the folks who are like listening to Dave Matthews Band and like wearing polo shirts. Yeah.
By the way, Young Hua, what a great MC alias.
No, I totally agree with that. I think that when you're young, you're convinced that, you know, there are these paradoxes, there are these contradictions, but you still have the energy to think that you'll figure out the way out, you know, that you'll figure out a different way to grow old, you'll figure out a different way. And when I'm teaching, I still have faith that my students will figure out things that I couldn't figure out. But I think that you know, when I was younger, writing this character, who's me, I think I just thought of one's true self or identity as being a project with like a discrete end. And then the older you get, you're sort of like, no, it's a process. You have to like be open to things. It sounds so simple in retrospect, but I think that I thought that there was just sort of like this place we would arrive to where things would be better, or the world will have been burnt down by this moment. But in reality, you're just sort of engaged in this struggle, and it's harder to see it. It's harder to see the full context when you're younger, or at least it was for me, so.
I think about how both of you were sort of subsuming yourselves, or your characters are subsuming themselves through what are in cultures, right? In lieu of the actual emotional traumas. So it's like activist culture, organizing culture, or pop culture. And meanwhile, you're also sort of surfing this like collegiate experience. And then on top of that, kind of, you know, you actually start with talking about your parents' story and why you're even in the United States to begin with. So I just keep thinking of these layers. You're asking yourselves questions about like who you were as a young person and how that informs who you are. And then also like who you're supposed to be. In all of that, how do you think about modeling now? Because, you know, I just want to dig a little bit into, as you get into a generation of modeling as opposed to being highly influenced by what's going around you, now that you've become an influencer, and I mean that in lowercase I, not like TikTok, but, or tell me about your TikTok personas. Yeah, I guess your role as influencers now. What does that look like on the other side of this arc?
I don't feel that at all. Even though I feel that when I'm teaching, because when I'm teaching, I teach at a college, and I think I'm very aware of how difficult it is to be a young person. You know, that every generation has their own traumas and own struggles. And so I've grown quite sensitive, I think, to the kind of particular challenges of being young in the world now. And so I guess when I'm teaching, I'm trying to model, like, how to be like you think back and the people, the teachers you've had who've really influenced you, I don't remember anything they actually taught me, but I remember like how they stood, how they talked to you, how they modeled thought, how they modeled kindness. And I think I've become more conscious that like maybe that's the only useful thing that a student might get out of my class, because I don't actually understand what postmodernism is to this day. But so like there's that, but then there's also this, the older I get, the more I feel like a humility that young people have a lot to teach me. So, I mean, I think it's one of those weird things about being a teacher that you don't realize until you're doing it, that you're actually secretly leeching off their energy and their hopes and their ambitions, and you're trying not to be a killjoy, you're trying to provide people with tools, yeah, or you know, workable models or like a menu of options. But I don't know, like I feel like I have fewer answers than I did when I was younger. Mm-hmm. You know, I feel like young Hua had a much stronger sense of what should be done. So
yeah, I agree with that. This woman came up to me after one of my readings, and she was like, listen, my daughter goes to Oberlin, and she's like that character. You need to come talk to her, because she needs to like not be this way. And I think she wanted me to like come sit her daughter down and be like, listen, I know you think you're like really radical, but like you need to like chill out. In my experience, that doesn't work. And I think I really agree with like so much of what you can do being embodied, like how you literally move through the world, because the people who helped me the most were often the people who just kind of like stayed still and like let me like give off my like brilliant theories and then just like sat there and didn't like try to fight with me or didn't try to like shut me down. And that was a big teaching. So if I can offer that to people, I think that is the best I can do.
That's awesome. I benefit highly from hearing that personally, yeah. I'm gonna take it downtown a little bit. We're all from California. We're all in the East Coast now.
Let's get into it.
Yeah, let's get into it. Asian California,
yes,
versus
yes,
the rest of Asian, yes, America. Because this is a really distinct characteristic of your stories, sure, is California. I'm gonna leave it there if you have thoughts on just having been out here for a while, and now not just New York, but like Hudson Valley versus Brooklyn, the co-op.
Have any more Californians showed up since we took the initial tally? Oh yeah, all right, cool. Yeah,
all right.
That seems more representative.
Are you a little scared? I'm a little scared.
No, but I'm curious. I mean, do you think you needed to be on the East Coast to write this novel, if that makes sense?
Yeah, absolutely. Something that, I don't know if you feel this way, but something that struck me about both of our books is that these characters, the Young Hua and my character, don't have language for their experience, right? They're going through their lives. It's this very, it's full of a lot of like boredom and ennui and just like driving around and not really being able to name what's going on. And, you know, in LA, I didn't really, like, know writers, let alone, like, people who worked in publishing. And so the way, like, American literature is structured still is such that New York, in particular, is the metropole. Mm-hmm. And so it's almost like an act of betrayal where you have to go to New York at some point in order to write about the place you're from. And this isn't true. This is true of, like, people from Colorado, from Florida, like, you still have to, like, kind of betray the place you're from because you have to explain it to New Yorkers. And that's something that I've really, like, felt heavily in the process of writing and publishing this novel. And at the same time, I don't regret it at all. Like, I feel very happy and lucky that this book is in the world, because to me, it's kind of a way of, like, writing that experience into existence. Like, who else was gonna like write about driving around Berkeley in the 90s and like looking at these record stores, but also like you know, reading Derrida. Like, that's such an experience that had to be put onto the page.
But, wait, do you mean that you felt like you needed to, like, professionally to be in New York, or did being on the East Coast give you a different perspective of your experience growing up on the West Coast?
I don't think it would have occurred to me to write a novel
yeah.
if it hadn't been for being in New York. And, like, the way Juan and I met was, like, at the launch party of the Asian American Writers Workshop's magazines in 2012. And that night, I met Hua and Alexander Chi, both. And that was the first time I'd sort of, like, met living writers. So it actually wouldn't have occurred to me that it was possible to name my experience in fictional form until I'd actually met living, working writers. Mm. So that community and that kind of sense of possibility, there's just such a density of that in New York. It might have happened if I'd stuck around, like, LA or the Bay long enough, but I don't know, yeah.
I mean, I guess if this is probably familiar to many people, but right, there is that stereotype of how, I mean, we sort of grow up with this abundance in the Bay Area and Los Angeles. And I think for me, I didn't grow up as concerned about, like, issues of representation because I grew up, you know, like my high school was like 40% Asian American, but within that it was pretty eclectic. You know, there were like jocks, there were the burnouts, like there were like people who were like sort of more traditionally academic. And so it didn't really, I mean, I remember I was talking to someone about Michael Chang recently and how, like, I didn't really care about Michael Chang, the tennis player, because there were so many good Asian tennis players in my high school. I'm like, oh yeah, like Michael Chang is just like better than like Nate Chang, but like, you know, but you know, like there were, and so I think for whatever reason, a lot of that experience became more, it just seemed more interesting once I was no longer in it. And once I was like on the East Coast, going to graduate school or meeting people who grew up in like very different circumstances and sort of what that does to your sort of like horizon of what's possible. And it is weird because the Bay Area, Los Angeles, like these are thriving, important global cities, and yet publishing is just sort of so solipsistic and so sort of concentrated in New York that it renders everything else regional when in reality, like, yeah, John Optic, that's like regional, you know, like that's actually as regional as someone writing about California. But yeah, it is interesting because in both books, there are these moments, I think, when the characters themselves reflect on this and just kind of what having both experiences like does for your sense of like what you want or who you can be.
Can I just add one? Something you made me think of is like, one big difference between my experience of like California, Asian America, is almost every East Coast Asian American I meet, and I would say most of the East Coast Asian American literature that's written is largely like shaped and formed by having to navigate whiteness at a very young age.
Yeah.
So like people talking about like being dropped into school in like first grade and like having to like talk to the Beckys and like having to like date white people to just like date anyone and like the trauma of that. And like, that's not really my experience as a California Asian. And I've like heard and like received a lot of like a mix of like mystification and envy from like the East Coast Asian folks I've grown up talked to.
Yeah, same. It's always jarring to me to hear somebody, and they're usually from the East Coast, say, I grew up wishing I was white. And it's a statement, just you would have been slapped, or I don't know, like, just it's just a weird thing to hear. But I've grown sort of sympathetic to the context. Like, it's a different context, you know, and we certainly had our own issues in California about where we fit in or didn't. I also just wanted to say about publishing, the other through line between us is the Writers' Workshop, So we're actually not just talking about writing on the East Coast, but being writers who worked with writers, right? Like we were kind of from a publishing milieu. And something I like to tell people is like when you're reading as a little kid, if you're somebody who really liked books, the very first thing you read is actually not the book, it's the copyright page. And it always says New York on every single page. So if you read hundreds of books as a kid, the very first thing and the only consistent sentence in every book is New York. Like, cause that's pretty much every book that was published in my childhood at least. So of course we're out here, or of course we came to New York and then went different ways. I recognize we're in Philadelphia.
I know, and you're getting a little too.
I know, Philadelphia is much cooler than New York. That's why we're here now.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Yeah, it is. Tell us more. Tell us about how Philly's awesome.
The fabric workshop.
Yeah.
Probably the best, like square foot for square foot,
yes.
The best art space I've been to in quite a long time.
100%.
It's incredible. Yeah.
Yeah. Have you been to
that? It's very close to here, so.
Yeah. It's really great.
I'm not trying to Philly-splain to Philly. it's awesome if you have
or cannibalize time. My hard-won audience, half of whom have never been here before. So stay here, and then, like, I don't know, next year, go to Fabric Workshop. No, they're great. Actually, changing gears again. I had this joke lined up in my head, and I was like, I don't know if I want to tell it, that I initially wanted J. Caspian King and Kathy Park Hong to be in conversation here, and I'm bringing that up just...
With us?
No, just them.
Oh,
like
them,
a
okay.
Cage fight.
Like we're the B-list.
Yeah.
Like they were the A-list, and then when they said no, they called us.
Jay was like, I just thought of Jay because you mentioned Michael Chang. I was like, I'm sure he has feelings about your feelings about Michael Chang, but...
He's the person I told those feelings.
Oh, wait. So J. Caspian King is producing a 30 for 30 documentary on Michael Chang and is not obsessed, just knows a lot and is a fan. So that's the joke. Jay is also a cultural critic I'll just pause there. Kathy, we all know minor feelings. I'm bringing that up on purpose just to talk about... In our generation, we have this wonderful thing now of like a lot of amazing Asian American cultural critics and people writing in magazines and like the peculiarity of our bylines. Like you already know what you're gonna get when you see their name, right? And it's not even politics. It's just sort of like, I think Dom and I were talking about Andrea Long Chu. We're like, you just know. And I'm putting you guys back into this sphere of influence again and just thinking about how far we've come as Asian American writers and like what it means to have diversity of opinions, diversity of politics. I guess I don't have a question. That was more of a comment than a question. But if you could talk a little bit about the writing industry, zeitgeist?
Wait, do you mean if you see their names, you know exactly what they're going to say already?
Or just sort of, I know that people sort of start to get ready energetically when they start to read Jay,
like,
or they start to...
I know what that's going to be.
Yeah.
Is that what you mean?
A little bit, but maybe more like... Let me rephrase the question. Do you feel like you get ready energetically when you see a byline by anybody I just named?
Like I'm going to answer the other question you asked, but because I don't probably read as much as new content. Mm-hmm. But you know, we were actually talking about this before because I do feel like it's an incredibly exciting time because. These two books are actually, I think if they were published at a different time, there would have been no real way of like, they would have been like completely inscrutable to the publishing market or to readers. I mean, I personally have benefited from like other people writing memoirs that were probably more self-consciously wanting to be like representative of the Asian American experience or something like that. Like, I didn't feel any pressure to do that at all. And that's probably the privilege of doing it in 2022 as opposed to trying to do it in 2012. And I mean, I think for you, probably similar, like you don't really feel the need to like solve these issues, but to sort of like offer your own provocation or your own kind of perspective on it.
Yeah, I feel very lucky to be writing right now because, okay, the first paragraph of my novel, you know, the mom and son are Korean American, and there's a joke about how like the mom pulls up in a Toyota Prius because like at one point we've got to like just let go of that shit with the Japanese colonizers. And then, you know, I knew when I wrote that probably like a huge percentage of people, if you just like handed this book to every person in America, maybe like 3% of people would get it. But that's all the people that I need to reach. And the other 97% will put it down. And that's actually like a huge freedom because I'm not trying to explain like, oh, you know, well, like when Japan annexed Korea in 1910, like, it doesn't have to be the Korean American novel that everyone reads. Mm-hmm. And that's like incredibly freeing. A lot of my friends are poets and they just do whatever they want because like no one expects them to sell a lot of books. And that's like great. So I aspire to that. I aspire to like doing exactly what I want as an artist and letting like those 3% of people like really love and get it, and like everyone else be like, I don't get this.
Yeah, I think you're actually, this is a great answer, because I guess what I was saying is like I feel like we're moving away from advocacy and now we're talking about opinions, which is so delicious.
Yeah, I mean, and I think you know, like in my book, Ken and I have very different perspectives on like what we want out of the world. Like he's much probably more, he's like more of a dreamer. He's like, I think that there should be an Asian guy on the Real World. You know, I think that we should be in the movies. And I think just being the kind of like indie guy, I was like, no, like I don't care about that stuff. Like MTV is lame. And that was probably just me not wanting to want something and know that I would be disappointed, right? But someone interviewed me and I went on this like weird tangent about that show, The Summer I Turned Pretty. Do people know what I'm talking about? It's like a Netflix show. Does anyone know what I'm talking about?
I think you're gonna have to
describe
it.
It's actually very popular, so I'm being surprised. But it's like, it's just sort of like a, I don't know, like a rom-com type TV show, but like, the mother is Korean American, the kid is Korean American. And like, this is like actually like disproving my point, because I was like, it's a very popular show, but clearly you have discerning tastes. This is an audience full of young Hwas and not consumers of mass culture. But, and then the person was like, wait, are you like saying that this show is good? Because I would say it just sort of blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, no, I'm just saying that there is this sort of this wider range of things being made. And so like, I could hate that and I don't have to feel bad about hating it. Like I remember when Better Luck Tomorrow came out, which is a movie some of you may know as well, in the early 2000s, a landmark achievement for Asian American filmmakers, but you sort of felt like you kind of had to be
sure.
Supportive, you know?
Yeah.
And this is, I'm like the 100,000th person to make this observation, but you know, it's just kind of cool that I haven't seen Minari and I don't feel like I'm a bad Asian,
yeah.
You know?
I haven't either. let's talk about the movies we refuse to see.
So, you know, I think that our books kind of enter into that too, and it's great, it's exciting. Mm-hmm. Like nobody has to, it's we've moved so far past the, like Maxine Hong Kingston, Frank Chin, like only one of us can prevail model of publishing and of like cultural creation. I mean, I guess on the other hand, like there's less of a monoculture, there's less of these like kind of common questions we might want to ask. Mm-hmm. There might be this idea that like people are constantly trying to like reinvent something that people have already done in the past, but you know, I think it's also like very exciting too.
Yeah, I think I'm hearing another way of talking about writing too that's changed, which is very much like, oh, I don't read books. But if you said that 20 years ago, it meant you were like kind of a willful jerk, like, ah. And now I'm hearing, oh, because I'd rather consume online culture, or don't you know about this amazing thing called the internet? So I think that's kind of a funny, we're in a funny place on that timeline too, where like writing, like getting a book deal used to be it, that's it, like, yay. But not so much anymore, right? Or that's what I'm saying.
I mean, I was still excited.
Yeah, but I'm excited. No, don't get me wrong. It's like, oh my God, I want nothing more than I have a book deal, many book deals. But maybe I'm just talking to the wrong people.
No, but it is like this thing where you know, the great American novelist, or if you believe in that, like that person's probably making a cool video game. Or something. You know what I mean? They're just like other outlets for things, mm-hmm. especially for. Like, I watch these Asian American barbers on TikTok, and I'm like, maybe in a different moment you would have been a musician or you would have mm-hmm. done something else, mm-hmm. but it's just so much easier to just perform your own persona.
Yeah.
And for people to watch it. I don't know if it's good or bad, but it's just different. So.
Yeah.
I agree with all of that, and I will also say, okay, is anyone here a writer or like interested in writing? Okay. I will say that, like, that is true, and also, at the same time, if you just look at like the sheer number of people in the world who read and write, this is probably like the most literate time in human history, right? So like, as a percentage of the culture, like publishing a novel versus TikTok, of course TikTok is like exponentially more popular. But in terms of like the actual number of people who are engaging in a serious way with like books and ideas and concepts and storytelling, the numbers are pretty great. Mm. And I would also say, like, that is still kind of like where people turn to move conversations forward, like to give us like bigger frameworks. Mm. And I don't think that's going to change anytime soon, actually. Mm.
That's awesome. Yeah. Well, I have many questions, and I feel like I'm actually looking at this page of words. I don't remember why I said some of these things. All right, so Asian Americans, pop culture, East Coast, West Coast, time. I'm gonna come back to writing again because there's this kind of, the graduation of these two young characters feels like your young Hua decides to write, right? That's the last thing he says in your book. And there's this like, it's like the result of therapy. And so I guess I wanna talk a little bit about writing process for each of you. Aside from feeling like compelled by being on the East Coast to write about a West Coast experience, or not, yeah, what ultimately was the, like, this is now happening now? When did writing start?
So for me, it was actually, I don't know if folks followed this story, but in 2014, a Chinese-American police officer shot and killed a young black man in the public housing stairwell of the Pink Houses in New York, Kai Gurley. And I was part of kind of some activist movements, and we were, you know, standing with Black Lives Matter, and actually, you know, in real life doing these teach-ins on like Black Asian solidarity and what that meant and the histories of that. And then what happened, of course, is like Chinese Americans in New York poured out in the tens of thousands in support of the police officer, Peter Liang, like marching en masse, and like the New York Times was covering it, and it was national news, and everyone's like, oh my God, Asians are like being politicized, but not in the way we thought. And I knew in real life that my mother was working on something called the Black Korean Alliance in the 1980s in Los Angeles, in South LA. And of course, talking, trying to broker and develop conversations between the Black and Korean communities about all the violence that was happening in South LA. And so what was very clear to me was that this was a historic cycle, like some unresolved issues between these communities had carried over into the present, and it felt like we were literally just turning the wheels where the same kinds of media coverage was going out, the same kinds of like stereotypes and disagreements between the communities. And that was the impetus. That was why I wanted to write this book. I was actually not like that good of a writer, a fiction writer, but I knew that fiction was the way to write this story that wasn't like a political manifesto. It wasn't like, this is what we need to do to get on the program, but it actually had the emotional capacity to get these characters into a new understanding of their own histories and of each other. And to me, that is actually how you break those cycles. Mm. So I actually, I was like a little backwards maybe from a lot of people where I didn't always know I wanted to be a novelist, but I knew I had this story that I needed to write. Mm. And then I like, you know, went and met all these people at Asian American Writers Workshop. I went and got an MFA. I drafted like many, many versions of this novel. And I'm really happy with the way it turned out formally. Like I had to learn form. But the real like driving force was those deep emotional, historical, and political questions.
So you went to get the MFA because you needed the skills to write the novel that you thought that you wanted to write.
Yeah, it's kind of like when people are like have this great idea for like a business and then they have to like go to business school. It was like that.
It's very similar actually, because like I said earlier, you know, the sentences in this book were written on, you know, like July 20th, 1998, like the day after we found out that my friend was killed. Like the first thing I did was I went to a store and bought a journal and just started writing stuff down. And so for quite a while, I was just writing to him, writing letters to myself, writing memories, just sort of archiving inside jokes, you know, because, you know, I'm sure if anyone who's sort of suffered loss, you sort of understand that like once memories become finite is when you sort of start to really hoard and obsess over them. Like if you're just going to continue generating new memories with your friends, you're not going to be precious necessarily about those memories, especially the banal ones, because you have all the time to create new ones. And so for quite a while, I was just working on it in this journal or just on these various documents. But, you know, I was working as a journalist and as a critic, and I had no idea how to write a memoir or how to shape all these notes and these, like, sensations into anything that anyone else would want to read, because so much of it was just for myself. So much of it was just a form of escape in a way. And so much of it was fixated on like that night and that moment and the friendship and the past. And so it took me quite a while to actually, you know, I had like a lot of notes, a lot of like scraps. I had this like envelope full of just notes on the backs of bar receipts and like airline tickets and things. But it didn't really, it was sort of like I knew that writing something in the first person was the form. I wasn't going to interview all my friends and re-report our life the way some people do when they write memoir. I needed it to be full of like flaws in my own memory, you know, and that haze of memory as well. And then it took me a long time, but I think the thing that changed for me personally was just realizing that the part I read before ends with me saying, like, someday you thought you would write the saddest story ever. I think realizing that it could also be funny. Mm-hmm. It could also have, like, joy. It could also be, like, boring and banal, because, like, being young and being with friends is just, you know, it's just, like, there's this banal ecstasy of boredom. You know, like you're just bored with people, and that's just sort of where friendship happens. That none of that stuff, like the jokes, none of that would diminish the tragedy. None of that would make light of what had happened, even if I was making light of myself. And so I think once I realized it could be happy and sad at the same time was when I realized, like, oh, this is actually no longer just like a really long journal entry or something.
Something I appreciated about this was that it, for a story about grief, you're actually telling a story about a friendship, right? Because it's not start, it doesn't start with the grief or the trauma or the death. It's, you just go right into, this is college for Yang Hua. And I just want to name my favorite, it just still makes me laugh, the image you describe of having a poster of Bjork on your ceiling that was so big that it would frighten you every time you woke up.
Yeah, it was like probably twice this, maybe like 1.5 times the size of one of those panels. Uh-huh. It was I mean, my favorite day of year at college is the poster day, because kids still do that. Like the poster guy still comes and sells all these posters, and so I was like, what are the hot posters this year? But I bought like a Bjork subway poster, but I didn't know what a subway was or how big a subway station must be, and so the poster was 1.5 times the size of that and hung over my bed, and it was terrifying.
Sorry, I totally distracted from this very, you know, you're talking about a tribute to a memory and a person, but I did appreciate that it was really the story of how you became friends and then this thing happened, not this is how I've been processing the thing that happened, right? I said at the beginning we talk about this idea that both things can be true, and I do feel that, I just hear that in my head a lot as I read both, and I think, you know, which side are you on? And I think the sentiment is actually even uttered. But I wonder too, just in light of the climate and everything going on, you know, we'd never want to be caught saying all lives matter, but when you say things like things can be true at the same time, contradictions can exist, I can not have to change somebody's mind. Like, what's that feel like to write that in, or do you feel any tension around this idea of like living inside a contradiction?
Yeah, so the title of the novel comes from a movement song, Which Side Are You On? Which was, came out of Kentucky coal miners like 100 years ago, and has been used again and again. And my feeling about the title is that in a given like political situation, you have to decide what side you're on. Like, it's very ethically and politically important to understand where you are in relation to what's happening. And as you pointed out, at the exact same time, there are no sides. That we are actually connected in these fundamental ways that go beyond political divisions. But not in a way that erases those political divisions. Mm-hmm. And so it's actually not something that you can hold in your mind. It's not something you can hold cerebrally, but it's something that you can hold in a more like embodied understanding of a situation. And that is something that the narrator eventually gets a little closer to. Mm-hmm. He's very much on the like, which side are you on, good or bad, kick until like, with a lot of force, he's forced to soften that a little bit and come to the other understanding.
Yeah, I couldn't put that any better. I mean, I think that there is, I think that is what I was aspiring to represent as well, only on a much smaller scale of just like, you know, you figure out who you are based on your relationships to the people closest to you. And so if you, like Yang Hua, become obsessive about these like micro distinctions, and of course you're going to be like, I'm on this side, you're on that side, even though to 99% of the world, like, there's no distinction right. between these two bands, right? Right? Or whether or not you wear a braided belt. but I think for me, it was just sort of this sort of reminder to myself, as well as maybe, you know, to anyone who's reading it, who is that age, that there are these Yeah, I mean, there is this sort of like more fundamental linkage. It doesn't mean that the political stuff goes away, just that it maybe opens up new possibilities of reckoning or a friendship. So, but I didn't really think about the context of the world, because when I was writing it, I wasn't trying to really figure out anything about the world the way I think Ryan was interested in Akai Gurley and Peter Liang. Like, I was really trying to not think about it, because I needed to kind of dislodge something to then kind of move on for myself.
Lovely. On that note, let's dislodge this audience and open it up for questions. If you want to just kind of let us know, and I'll, Dominique will.
Thanks for being here.
Hey, thanks guys for being here. This has been great. Hua, I had a question for you. A couple questions, actually. First was, how was it being on Fresh Air with Terry Crews? Great interview, by the way.
Super weird.
Yeah.
She's, wait, you really want?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll just say it's camera off, so you never see each other. Mm-hmm. Very kind person. Approach to questioning can be very unpredictable.
True.
Yeah, so it's like, it's, And I met someone else who had been on, and you know, some questions, like probably best for both of us, weren't aired. But I think, I met someone who is very obsessive about Fresh Air and said that she had diagrammed every episode ever. And I do think that it's effective to just kind of be erratic and random, because it kind of makes you come up with new answers. Like, I thought that I had gotten so many reps that I would know exactly what to say, but I was just constantly confused, so. It was cool. It was very cool.
I was just kind of curious, because if you remember, I'm Russell, I interviewed for Publishers Weekly back in June.
You're the first person to interview me.
Yeah. I did have a second question. It was about the photographs in your memoir. And I'm curious if, like, about your process selecting those photographs, if there were some that didn't make the cut, or, you know, you picked ones that pertain to specific passages. Just a little bit about your process.
This one is of me on ecstasy on the banks of the Charles River.
Amazing.
It's great. I love it. When? It was, you know, I think that it was a rough time. It was my editor's idea. I had no vision of how art could function in the book. And I think we kept thinking about W.G. Zabold, the great German writer.
Absolutely.
But it's sort of impossible to use that, because, and also, do you like Zabold? Yeah, I mean,
what was a huge influence on this book?
You know what's crazy is, like, I've read all of Zabold's books. I'm very into this style, because it's deceptively simple writing, and yet it's actually, like, quite dense, and there are all these images in it, and the images make you feel like it's all true, but none of it is actually, I mean, it's not a spoiler, but it's actually not, most of it is not true at all, you know, and I didn't know that until fairly recently, and I think that we use the photos similarly. Like, they're not meant to be captioned. They're not like evidence or specimens or exhibits. It's more just like, it's just like college. You know, you're walking down the hall, you poke your head in the door, you may wonder what these people are like, and then you keep it moving. So it's sort of more of these glimpses than it is anything that's meant to be read, actually. Also, there's no chapter titles or chapter divisions, so it was just a way to break up the text, too. But I'm really happy that I have this, you know, some of the pictures are sort of embarrassing, so like the one I just showed you. So it's like funny to me that it's in a book.
I think my favorite is still the 7-Eleven sign.
Yeah.
From the slant. Yeah. Awesome. Thank you.
Can I just respond to that? Yeah. I really love the photos also in this, and I read it as like you making the book more into a zine.
If you haven't read this,
there's zine making was a big part of Hua's life. So it's like I read it as like you kind of like de-gentrifying the finished book product, right? And like making it a little more like handmade and like a little more personal.
Yeah, that was part of it too, just sort of bringing in, because the photos came up because I referenced this picture in a zine, I write about like making the zine, having this picture, and then my editor made a note, and I'm like, well, I'm a hoarder, so of course I still have that picture. And he said, well, let's put it in the book. But yeah, it was supposed to kind of give you that kind of like feel as well.
Hi, thank you so much for both of you for your writing and for being here. Ryan, I just wanted one of the comments that I had while I was reading your book, that I underlined was about, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Was about having Korean parents who are really against activists, and my father actually ripped my Communist Manifesto in half, so, and then he patched it back together because he felt really bad. But I was wondering, you know, if you could share a little bit more about the characters' experiences and maybe how they overlap with yours about having activist parents. And then I was also wondering, when you talked about fiction as the preferred form, why not memoir? And on that note, Hua, did you ever consider writing this as a fiction?
Yeah, so for those who weren't here at the beginning, my parents are in the audience. And I was like, I was thinking about tonight, and I was like, you know, shout out to the matriarch Margaret Cho. Like, if Margaret Cho can do her stand-up routine in front of her parents, I can do this in front of my parents. So, you know, my parents went to Berkeley in the 70s. They were very much part of like kind of the world that Hua references in his book of like this political culture that was shaped at Berkeley and really like traveled around the world in many ways. One of the things I would always get for my entire life, especially meeting like Asian American activists, was like, oh, it's so cool that your parents are activists, and like that's amazing, and it is, I love that. But it's also like, how do you know? You know, people assume that people like project something onto that experience. My parents actually made the conscious choice not to really like put their politics on me growing up. So it really wasn't until like 5-7 years ago where I was like, you know, reading all the stuff about the LA uprising. And I like, you know, sat them down and like put on my iPhone recorder, and I was like, so what were you doing in 1992, you know? I think I also just like, what's interesting about that example you shared is like, you know, in a lot of Asian diaspora communities, there is both like traditions of like fierce anti-communism and also fierce communism. I think that's really interesting. You know, the popular narrative around Asian America is being apolitical and removed from politics. But actually, you know, as soon as you like start to trace the histories, both in America and like before coming to America, there actually are these like very rich and powerful traditions of, you know, Marxism, third world solidarity, all these major global movements. So I think it's often not as far as the popular story says it is. Yeah. And why fiction? Initially, partially just like to have a little distance, honestly, like to not have everyone know exactly what was true. But actually, again, you know, you come to fiction, I think, for slightly different reasons than nonfiction. With nonfiction, the driving force is information, is truth. There's something that does to you as a reader that pulls you in a way that fiction doesn't. And I was interested in something that fiction offers, which is emotional internal transformation. I still think fiction is one of the great vehicles for modeling what it's like to change your worldview in a fundamental way through a story. Yeah.
That's a great answer, and that's exactly why I can't write fiction, because when I was working on this, I didn't know what the transformation was, so I had to write it, and I only figured out these things about myself in the act of writing. So I wouldn't have been able to fictionalize anything because I was still figuring it out as I was writing it. Also, I'm terrible at fiction. Like, I can't. It's like when you learn to play the guitar and then everything just sort of regresses to Smells Like Teen Spirit or something. Like, I just have no original creative instinct. I always need to like be poaching from someone else's life or my own. So.
Thanks, guys, for being here. This is a question for Hua.
Thank you for being here.
And full disclosure, I went to high school with Hua, so, and I haven't seen him for about 20 years. But
I still have all these cassettes that Vincent made. That
and I have cassettes from Hua as well. That's a whole story. So I guess I have two questions, or the first one is more of a point. One, I'm here to tell you that you are, in fact, a bad Asian for not having watched Minari. But the second one is actually on the subject of music. I'm curious, you know, 25 years now into the future, how do you think about your music from that era? Is it just sort of an artifact that's tinged with nostalgia, or does it still have huge emotional weight for you now whenever you revisit?
Yeah, I mean. I think when we're listening to music, part of the reason it's so powerful is because you hear all the other times you've heard it. You know what I mean? It's like the experience just sort of accrues over time. And so, you know, some of us are chasing that thrill of like the first time I heard like this thing that I'd never heard before. But you're also just kind of trying to recall, you know, the thousands of other times. It's like an index of your own life. And part of what happens in the book and part of what actually happened was that, you know, around 1998, I needed music that was evacuated of any context. And so I actually just stopped listening to everything I was into from like high school through 1998 and started kind of aggressively getting into other kinds of music, you know, partly because it had no emotional meaning for me, you know, so... But now, like, I've gone back and really just as I was finishing the book or writing the book, I started listening to, like, a bunch of the stuff that I was really into from 95 to 98. And I do find it very, like, resonant. You know, like, it does kind of hit me, but not in a way where I'm like, oh, I was so innocent back then. It's just more like re-encountering an old friend. You know, you're just kind of like, oh, I haven't listened to this in so long, because for so long it was like very vexing to be put into these like weird emotional spaces. But it's just very comforting now. So
hi. Thank you so much for being here and for your work and for this conversation. So I promised my friend who really wanted to be here tonight but couldn't make it that I would ask this question for her. This is a question for both of you, but it's related to a thing you said once, Hua, in an article about authority. And just, this is like a craft question. My friend is a journalist who's working on a creative nonfiction book. You wrote, or you said in this interview, when I write, I try to begin from a place of authority and then I try to lose it over time. I want to transfer it to the reader, which I think is so interesting, and my friend is actually working on trying to lose her authority. She's trained as a journalist. And so I'm wondering how, like, what did you mean by that, and how do you do that? And then also for Ryan, you know, in writing your novel, like, how did you think about authority with your voice and techniques for trying to accomplish what you were going for? Thanks.
I think what I meant was that all writing is about a relationship between a reader, writer and a reader, right? And there's the world outside of that relationship, but you can't really control how they feel about the world, or I can't, rather, when I write, because that's not how I write. But I can control how empowered they feel about entering into that world. And so when I'm writing, I think when a piece opens, this is getting like kind of in the weeds, but I try and make it seem like I really know what the answer is, or I try and establish my authority early on, but I'm also very interested in carving out space for a reader to enter into a piece and say like, oh, I hear it differently, or maybe this other thing is possible. I'm really into this band Can, and this guy Irvin Schmidt, who's a member of Can, said that like, for him, great art is art that like creates a space inside of it for a reader to enter, or for like a listener to enter into, and whether you're listening or dancing or just like nodding along, like you are part of the performance then. Like these are all ways of engaging with art. And so, I think by the end of a piece, I'm always interested in disquiet, or maybe opening it out so that I'm asking questions that I don't have the answers for, but hopefully a reader can kind of see past what I've said and have an answer. Does that make sense? So like in my book, in my memoir, I do that a lot, because early on in the book, I'm always quoting Derrida, or like I quote a lot of people, but then by the end of it, none of that stuff really matters, and that there are these things that maybe a reader can enter into that have nothing to do with like external authority, but more about what they bring to what an audience or a spectator or a reader brings to the art as an active participant. Does that make sense? I don't know if it works, but that's what I'm often like trying to do.
Mm. Can I ask a follow up? So to invite the reader to be an active participant. That's so interesting. I'm curious. So like there you mentioned like asking questions that you the writer don't know the answer to. There's also this kind of arc of like being humbled, I suppose, like being really like expert in authority at the beginning, and then like that humbling arc. But yeah, I guess I don't totally understand what you mean still, but that's okay.
Yeah, I think it is just like asking questions and kind of revealing one's own, like being open to not having the answers, which I think a lot of critics, and I usually write criticism, that's not necessarily what you think you're supposed to do. But I think if you can convey that like, look, this is just what I'm hearing, or this is just what I want out of the world, that implicitly invites someone to think what they want out of the world too. And so, I don't know if I'm successful in doing that, but that's sort of what I like writing to do, which is not to tell me what to think, but just to present these possibilities, and then maybe I could take them in a different direction.
I think it's very similar for me to what you said. The way that showed up for me the most with this novel was political authority. So when I started writing this novel, I think I had on some level this idea that like, oh, I've got these like great interviews with my parents, and like I'm gonna like put them on the page, and then we're really gonna like get on the program together. Like I'm gonna have answers about what we should do. Those early drafts were really bad because if you are trying to do that as a fiction writer, you will like really make your reader suffer. They'll feel like they're being lectured at, and like as readers, no one wants that. People want to be invited into a conversation. And so to let go of authority and to just be like, this is literally just my view. This is literally just like one person's experience. That's the only honest way to write, I think, but it's a much more like radically vulnerable position to be in because that's just it. It's just like you're naked to the world, you know?
At what point, assuming your parents have read the book, they've not. at what point did you have them read it, or did you feel like it was okay for them to read it?
Yeah, I signed with an agent, and that was the moment where I was like, okay, there's a chance this book will be in the world and read by other people. So I was like, it would only be responsible for me to share this with them. I sent them a hard copy in the mail. And I gave my mom the tracking number, and she like tracked it. So she like sat by the door until it was like delivered at 8 p.m. And she stayed up reading it till 1 a.m.
Wow.
And then my dad wakes up early, and he got up at 5, and then he read it. So like within 12 hours,
wow,
they
had
both read this novel. and you know,
were you anxious?
Here. Oh yeah. I wrote them a whole like preamble. I was like, any resemblance to characters is purely coincidental or used fictitiously. Yeah. Had a lawyer. No. how about you? Have your parents read it?
Yeah, my parents. But I was more concerned about like friends in the book reading it, so I gave friends the option of changing their names and whatnot. But yeah, I was more concerned about like his mother reading it, friends who were in the book more than like a couple times, and then. And a lot of friends who I hadn't talked to in a while, but yeah, that was probably the most like anxiety-producing period. Was just kind of because it didn't really matter as much what, because I just wanted to know what they thought, you know, and I knew that it would lead to kind of weird conversations. So,
I guess as far as speaking to being aware of who might read your book and paying attention to the larger zeitgeist as far as Asians being in popular media, to what degree did y'all both think of your readers? Were you imagining a specific person? Maybe were you perhaps writing to a younger version of yourself? Or, you know, I feel like a lot of Asian media now, there's maybe a wink of a, if you know, you know, you know, I'm not gonna explain this. But at the same time, I imagine there might have been some pressure from your editor or publisher to say, you know, the average non-Asian reader might not understand this. Was there any grappling of that kind?
I was writing it for, I was literally just like, this was the book that I was looking for when I would go like record shopping at night or like go to the bookstore. Like, this is what I wanted to read. And if other people engage with it, that's cool too. But yeah, I mean, I think once the process got rolling, there were these kind of moments when someone would be like, what do you mean by, you know, like even the East Coast, West Coast, Asian American thing, like I didn't know if anyone would really understand what I was getting at with like a fourth generation Japanese American seeming like a total alien to me. But, you know, it goes back to the question, like we don't necessarily have to explain all of these things now. And it's also kind of, this pairing is like great, just not because Ryan and I know each other, but you know, these are pretty non-stereotypical representations of like parents or like family structure. And I don't think that it stands out as much as it might have like 5 or 10 years ago. And I don't think that, I didn't feel any pressure to not write it that way, because it seems like there's more space. But yeah, there's certainly stuff where it's like, if you know, you know. But I actually thought of it more as like regional. Like if you're in California, you may see things. If you're Taiwanese American, you may see things. But I didn't feel as much pressure. Did anyone pressure you to
No, I was really lucky also. So, you know, again, like, I can't emphasize this enough, but I actually would not have become a writer without community, and, like, in particular, Asian American arts community. So as part of the workshop, I did this fellowship called Kundimon. I was just hanging out with a bunch of Asian American writers. And that's not just like nice socially, but it meant that I could envision a room full of people kind of like this, where like people would understand what I was talking about. And that was actually critical in terms of like knowing that there would be someone who got what I was talking about. So there are like a lot of references in the book that like I don't necessarily expect everyone to get. And they're not really to wink at people. They're really because those references are history. And I wanted to like assert that. So like, you know, Cav is mentioned, Yuriko Chiyama, Grace Lee Boggs are mentioned, the LA Uprising is mentioned, a lot of like LA culture is mentioned. But that's just what I grew up with. That's just the world I came from. And having community meant that I didn't have to like second guess that about myself. I was also lucky in that my editor was Asian American, Megha Majumdar, who's also a novelist. And the one part that was like, this was really helpful because like the part she was confused about, I'm not like, oh, you're just like putting the white gaze on me. She was just like genuinely confused about like, for example, some of the parents' like leftist histories, because she just like literally had never heard those stories before. So that was really helpful, actually. That wasn't about like catering those details, but it was about like how do you actually explain this to someone who just hasn't like met those people.
We do have a question from our live stream that I can read. Someone asks, and this is a question for Hua. Having been at Berkeley at the dawn of the internet and internet-bound Asian American culture, how does it feel to see the landscape now?
And can you repeat that?
Yeah.
The landscape of the internet?
I guess it's open-ended, like what landscape, but yeah, maybe social media or online Asian American culture. Having been at Berkeley at the dawn of the internet and internet-bound Asian American culture, how does it feel to see the landscape now?
How old are you?
How old are you?
No, I'm 35. I'm 45.
I'm 34. Yeah.
You're 34? Yeah. Wow.
Is that higher though?
No. Just it's hard to tell how old an Asian person is generally. So, I thought you were either 24 or 44.
I'm 72.
So, Ryan looks a lot like one of my relatives too, which is why it always like messes with me. I was there for the beginning of the internet in 1995. Nobody took email seriously. Like, there was a guy who signed up for email as shit at UC Link 4. and it was just, like, funny. You know, like, oh, that's cool that, like, Joey did that, you know. Because nobody thought that any of this would matter. I think that my main thing with thinking about, because, like, I don't feel like my book's very nostalgic. Like, I personally feel nostalgic for aspects of my own life, but the book's intention isn't for you to think, like, oh, like 1996 sounds fun. But the only thing I'll say is that we stepped into so much smaller of a world back then, even if you went on the internet. Like, we used to troll right-wing chat rooms on AOL at night, and then afterwards, when I was, like, grieving, I would go during the day, because I would just be, like, by myself all the time, but like nobody was on the internet during the daytime. Like, it just wasn't a thing to do, and everyone would go on at night because you didn't go on the internet during the daytime. And so it was just sort of like manageably vast. Like, it was exciting because, you know, like, you could meet people in Canada who were into this band that you're into, but you could only meet like a dozen of them, you know, and it would only be updated, you know, like once a day or something. It wasn't like overwhelming. And so I think that's an aspect of the internet that it's hard to explain, just how it felt like this incredibly new, it felt like this new world, but it was like you wouldn't lose your mind going on it the way I think anyone with a phone would feel that way now. So I don't know how other people feel, but that's one thing that really stands out for me. Sure.
Thank you, internet question, for that internet question. Thank you, live audience, for the live audience. And thank you to two living writers for being writers. Shit's tough. Thanks for coming to AAI. Books are for sale. We have snacks. Please hang out. And thank you, Hua and Ryan.